we're a bit short of time, and I want to get to this issue on free speech. What prompted you to make this captain's call on banning these alt-right speakers coming to using council venues?
Well, it's not a captain's call for a start. It's fully in line with Auckland's policy, which we've just agreed to.
Well, it might be, but you made the call as mayor, didn't you?
Yeah, but it's about our city's has to be an inclusive city. We're hugely diverse. 40% of Aucklanders are born overseas. So when the Regional Facilities Auckland came to me and said, we've got this problem, these people want to use our facilities, they said they were concerned that the speech that these two individuals were engaged in was deliberately provocative to some of our ethnic communities and our faith communities. My view was very clear. I'm not against free speech. They can come here. The people that are paying $50,000 in legal fees to promote their right, they can provide them with a
yes, but
with
I want
a
to
hall
know
somewhere
you
or a
think
cow
it's
paddock
your
somewhere.
Right. Why is it your right to make that call?
It's my obligation, first of all, to follow the advice that I get from Regional Facilities Auckland that said this will be a security threat, and by the way, it's probably inconsistent with the guidelines that we operate under, which is not to bring the council
fine.
Into
You're
disrepute.
You're drawing a line. That's fine. I want to know why you think you are able to make that decision and not the court. Because that's what people are very upset about. They look at and they think you're acting like a dictator.
No, the people that support dictators are the people that aren't coming now to Auckland. They're the ones that said Hitler was a social justice warrior and said that the colour of their skin depends your IQ.
Maybe you're right, but that's not the point.
Now, I've got an obligation, Corin. Just listen to this for a second. I've got an obligation to promote a city that is inclusive. I've got an obligation to protect ethnic and religious minorities who are being brought into contempt, who are being abused, provoked and insulted by the sort of language that these people are using. That's why the United Kingdom banned them from coming to the United Kingdom. What I'm saying is, I'm not banning them. I'm just not going to aid and abet their malicious comments about part of our community by providing them with a venue.
But have you not now amplified this issue in the sense that with these toxic culture wars, you've really elevated their status and you've elevated this debate, haven't you? Did you need to do that?
These people were coming to New Zealand exactly for that purpose. They were coming to use provocative speech attacking religious and ethnic minorities in our country. Now, is it my role to facilitate that? No. There would have been a debate if we'd granted them the right to use our halls, because a very large section of Auckland would have said, what the hell are you doing helping
these
people that many would describe as neo-fascist, that engaged directly in racist comments that would have been in breach of the Human Rights Act under Section 61. I simply made the call to agree with Regional Facilities Auckland that we should not be facilitating their use of our venues.
Can I just ask you before we finish this, wouldn't you have to, on this logic, prevent Donald Trump from speaking at one of your venues?
But
he said in this interview over the weekend, I think what has happened to Europe is a shame. When he's talking about immigration, allowing the immigration to take place in Europe is a shame. He's gone on to, clearly provocative language around migration and the exact same issues you're talking about. You would have to ban him.
No, there's a difference in degree. I don't agree with much, in fact, most of what Donald Trump says. I'm not about banning him, but I am about banning people who say that Hitler was provoked into the Holocaust to massacre 6 million Jews, who say that I can judge you on your IQ, on the colour of your skin. The sort of stuff that they are using in their language, designed deliberately to incite and provoke minority groups who are already subject to quite a lot of abuse
because of their being minorities. You're happy to fight this in court?
Oh, absolutely, and we'll win.
Phil Goff, Mayor of Auckland, we'll leave it there. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Right, after the break, we will get the panel's view on this and their hits and misses of the week. Plus, welcome back to Q&A. Let's get straight into it now on this issue of free speech. Heather Roy, has Phil Goff overstepped the mark here in your view?
Yes, I think he has. It's the captain's call aspect that you talked about. So the venues in Auckland are run by Auckland Live through Regional Facilities Auckland. And it's for the management and the directors of those organisations to make the call, not the mayor, who isn't an executive director. of the council or
leadership,
those,
though, isn't it? He's being a leader.
He is being a leader, and he's convinced himself it's the right thing, but where does that stop? So freedom of speech is about people being able to say, unless they're breaking the law, to be able to say what they want. These two Canadians weren't known to anybody until a platform was given to them, and I think that Phil Goff has given them a platform when people saying hateful things like that should just be ignored. And I think, look, New Zealanders are robust. We've got a very robust society. People are quite capable of making up their own minds about whether these people have
valid
views or not.
And does it need to be challenged in court?
Well, I think now that he's gone out and made this call, I can understand why it's happening. I'm not sure that it necessarily is a good use of taxpayer money to go and do all of that and have the defence costs that will be associated with it. But I think that we should be defending freedom of speech, and no individual should be the arbiter of what other people are saying. And this is what he's doing.
Lila, was Phil Goff out of line to make this call?
First of all, I just want to say that I've got no sympathy whatsoever for the legal action against the council. I think, you know, it's misplaced. It's largely motivated by people who don't have an interest in honest, open debate around these issues. You know, Don Brash and so on. Well, I mean, we're talking here about...
Trotter. I mean, that's what they do, isn't it? They spend
the right
most of their time debating.
They have the right to have a view. I'm saying I've got no sympathy for the legal action whatsoever. On the other hand, I think the decision that was made by Phil Goff is highly problematic. We have public facilities which should be available for people to share, hear, pronounce views, and I don't think it's okay for there to be this sort of decision made to restrict access to those facilities to talk about what are offensive or provocative or disruptive ideas.
What's wrong with being a leader on this and saying, I'm taking a leadership stance here, if you don't like it, you can vote me out in a couple of years' time?
Well, because we can't vote him out, and what's wrong with the decision is I don't think it's put out in the frame of a real discussion about the use of public spaces. I think it's actually completely disingenuous to say that on the one hand I support these people or others' freedom to speak, but I will not give them access to public facilities. We're in a society where our access to platforms actually depends on our access to public facilities. So, you know, if you don't have access to public facilities, whether it's public broadcasting or an actual platform in a public hall to promote ideas, however controversial, however insidious,
so would you,
in this
what
particular
about, what about
case,
if just hypothetically,
then we don't have a culture of freedom of speech.
What about banning them at the airport?
Well, I think that's a different issue altogether.
And whether or not,
I don't know. I haven't examined the details of our visa entry requirements. I understand that there's some belief that because they've been banned from other places, they should automatically have been denied visas here. I don't have a comment to make on that, but I do think Goff's overstepped.
All right, Jennifer, I'm interested in this because it is a politician, I think, making a captain's call. He disagreed with that language, but he's made a leadership call here. We haven't seen that from a politician in New Zealand for a while on an issue like this. I mean, it really does throw up these culture wars.
Yeah, so I don't know about the culture wars because there's two parts to that question. I think it is quite clear that the politicians all have quite different perspectives on this, and we've seen this week in terms of Simon Bridges, Winston Peters, you know, having different positions to Goff and so on. So, And these sorts of values-based issues and culture issues tend to sit at a conscience level. They don't tend to sit with political parties' platforms. So it is shaking it up. I think the process is probably the problem, because if we had a mayor that then denied, you know, raving left-wing speakers from coming, we would see outrage as well. So there are some, you know, it's for the courts in a way to test what is racial vilification or provocative language, and so it's not really evident from some of the commentators that he's going to win this court case, even though he seems, you know, adamant
confident that
he will. Yeah, and in terms of culture wars argument, the thing is if we look at the people who are pro Goff's decision and those who are the free speech coalition people, yeah. The makeup of these groups and what we know about libertarianism and who tends to really champion these issues is that they tend to be largely European, highly educated, well-resourced people, often with assets, so very kind of middle class. And so whether or not this is actually going to capture the hearts and minds of the masses or voters out there when there are other things that they're concerned about, like what we saw on the west coast of South Island, is this really going to wedge
people? Well, let's go to a libertarian, I guess, over here, Heather. I wonder, there is, if you spend any time on Twitter or social media, you get a sense that there is a group of libertarian or centre-right voters who feel that free speech is under threat, not just because of this case, but in general.
I think it's, where's the tipping point? So you make a call like this on one issue, and then if one person's allowed to dictate who comes here, who has access to public venues, where does that stop? You know, do you start encroaching further and further into society and telling people what they can and can't say? And I think that's the difficulty with the freedom of speech group. But I think there's two issues here. There's the freedom of speech, which I think Gough has compromised this week, but there's also good governance. He's the mayor. He's not the arbiter of what happens at facilities either. And so he's also breached the principles of good governance as by being a mayor that's interfering in the running of the way these venues are
Lila, do you agree?
To be used.
Well, I think, we're talking here about people from overseas coming to promote a vile kind of position in New Zealand. But to be consistent, you'd have to look at what happens here in New Zealand and the vilification, the racism, the open sort of nastiness exhibited, for instance, towards Māori communities from public platforms over 100 plus years. So are we really going to monitor all public utterances in public spaces for their likelihood of offending or in fact, their just complete lie-telling about our own history from people who we, and some people, look up to as leaders within our own society. I just think it's highly problematic to try and draw that line in relation to this particular case. And in fact, I've never heard of these people, and I haven't researched them online.
I can tell you, it wasn't
the only repetition of their line that I have heard over the last week is from Phil Gough himself.
Well, it's interesting. Lauren Southern has arrived in Australia. She arrived there yesterday wearing a T-shirt saying it's okay to be white and went on Sky News. And so, it doesn't seem to be as a bigger deal over there. It is getting some media attention. Do you think we're just perhaps grappling with a new issue here? I don't know.
Well, actually Australia, from my understanding, initially denied them entry. And then there was a protest, and then they went back and had a look at it again and said, no, it's okay for you to come. And,
well, they've got a Pauline Hanson there, don't they?
Yeah. I mean, I think what they're, let's just say, left, right, or however we want to classify freedom of speech spectrum, looks quite different there. You can't really compare, populism, Pauline Hanson style, with, the equivalent. We don't have an equivalent, really, to Pauline Hanson here in Parliament yet. So that kind of lightning rod around, this kind of issue seems to be less present here in terms of firing up, But I agree that we can't, monitor everything, because there is a lot, if we look at the Freedom House Index, which ranks countries according to freedom of speech, civil liberties and that sort of thing, New Zealand ranks like 98 points out of a possible 100. Because our rule of law and our processes for protecting civil liberties and freedom of speech are really high. And actually Freedom House Index, the only caveat that they put on that around our 2 points is the discrimination that Māori and Pacifica peoples still face within New Zealand.
Is it, just finally, we've got a minute before we go to a look back, is it maybe a good thing that it goes to court and that leave it to the courts to settle? Will that appease people on both sides, maybe cool people down?
I don't think it should go to court. I think that the kind of what's happened in Auckland this week should be the subject of the kind of public discussion we're having here today and people are having. And, probably all three of us have argued all three positions with ourselves anyway over the course of this time. So it's just not a straightforward issue, and I don't have any particular belief that the courts are the people to resolve this issue. They're kind of issues that just need to be debated and talked about in communities. I'm not a free speech warrior. I'm all for banning hate speech. I'm all for stopping lies being told and repeated through defamation laws. But I do think it's kind of disingenuous to say we did this to protect the idea of diversity in Auckland when we have some quite deep issues around racism.
We will come back to the panel for some hits and misses.